I used to visit all the very gay places, those come what may places, where one relaxes on the axis of the wheel of life to get the feel of life.
I had a deep respect for Henry Kissinger, his knowledge, his background, and his philosophic outlook.
I thought he was intelligent, charming, and just a good companion.
I like Henry. I respect him. I think he has been a major force in our lives.
Dr. Kissinger is perhaps one of the major scholars in America and the world today in this area.
He was a fascinating mixture of power and strategy.
It wasn't just that power made you a celebrity. It's sometimes that just creating yourself as a celebrity gave you more power. Let your poignant smile.
Everyone has a New York dream.
Thank you so much for visiting our plant, Dr. Kissinger.
It was fun.
We'll let you know if your glasses turn up.
I think Kissinger is clearly an extraordinarily brilliant man. But he did have this, I think, this fatal flaw of preferring to act without public scrutiny.
Well, in Harper's Magazine this month, there's an article called The Case Against Henry Kissinger, The Making of a War Criminal. Explain, Christopher.
I think he's a war criminal.
Yeah, look at it crash! Look at it crash!
I think he's a liar. I think he's responsible for kidnapping, for murder.
My own view is that if we held Henry Kissinger to the standards we have begun to hold other leaders, other policymakers, and the standards to which we held policymakers in Germany and in Japan after World War II, yes, Kissinger ought to be the subject of an international tribunal, ought to be the subject of a legal process in the United States and elsewhere.
What are we to make of these accusations? Henry Kissinger is the recipient of the Nobel Peace Prize and the most famous American diplomat in history. Yet, armed with recent evidence, his critics claim that some of his past actions amounted to crimes against humanity. In a new climate of international justice, a re-examination of Kissinger's career may be in order.
The important thing before people die or go senile, like Pinochet, is to punish them, to provide retribution for the victims, a sense that they haven't or their relatives haven't died in vain, and to provide a deterrent, to make dictators, tyrants, cruel people, be they generals or national security advisors, now think that if they take the wrong course and abuse their power, they may be held to and may be punished at some time in the future.
Well, if I ask myself why I began my investigation into Henry Kissinger, it would go back as far as when I realized that he was a frightened man, because I became aware that he was personally frightened by the consequences of the arrest of General Pinochet. When the news of that hit, he instantly thought, could I be next?
Good evening. The former dictator of Chile, General Augusto Pinochet, has been arrested by police in London. The 82-year-old general is being held at the request of the authorities in Spain, who accuse him of the murder of Spanish citizens when he was in power.
In 1998, the front page of the New York Times announced that in cooperation with the case against General Pinochet, the U.S. government would release classified documents revealing American involvement in killings and torture in Chile. Kissinger may have received the news with some concern, as suggested by a phone call with his publisher, Michael Corder.
It's Mr. Corder for Dr. Kissinger. Henry, hi, how are you? No, I wasn't calling out of impatience. I was calling only to say that you're getting all the publicity you would want of the New York Times, but not the kind that you'd want. I also think it's very, very dubious for the administration to simply say, yes, they'll release these papers. This is a Spanish judge appealing to an English court about a Chilean head of state. So also Spain has no rational jurisdiction over events in Chile anyway, so that it makes absolutely no sense.
The day the British police, an arm of state power, go out to the house of Augusto Pinochet and declare him under house arrest is a victory for an idea about the protection of the right of all peoples.
Michael Tiger is a renowned litigator with a special interest in human rights and universal standards of justice.
So that's our basis. Now the next question is, well, who are we going to sue?
Tiger thinks that Henry Kissinger may have reason to be concerned about the new precedent set by the events surrounding the Pinochet arrest in London.
You know, here's this magistrate that everybody thought he's a good friend of Maggie Thatcher and he's just going to toss the case out, right? Well, he writes one law for one world. That's what he wrote in his judgment. For me, I tell you something, the most dramatic moment of the hearing about Pinochet was the testimony of the Scotland Yard officer. On such and such a date, I was handed a warrant and I went to a house. At 11:30, I was shown in. And I went in and I turned right. I then went into a room and I saw a man that I recognized as the prisoner. Prisoner, isn't that a great room? The prisoner. And I walked up to him and he stood. And I said, Augusto Pinochet Ugarte, I arrest you, sir, for the crimes of conspiracy and torture. And I tell you, I thought, busted. Busted.
I never like to miss a chance to confront Henry Kissinger, and I don't get that many, because when he knows I'm coming, or when he knows I'm going to be in the area, up till now he has cancelled, that's four times now this year. What I yearn for is the chance for some quality time with him. He refused to answer any questions when the Harper's articles were being written, but I do want to confront him and to make him realize that we're not going to stop asking.
In early 2001, author Christopher Hitchens published The Trial of Henry Kissinger. First released as two articles in Harper's Magazine, the book accuses the former Secretary of State of war crimes and crimes against humanity and asks for a formal legal inquiry.
The statement Henry Kissinger is a war criminal is a statement I've been making for many years. It's now not a piece of rhetoric, not a metaphor, it's a job description.
Across the U.S., Hitchens' improbable crusade attracted interest. With a pen for a lance, he was tilting at the windmill of Kissinger's reputation.
Christopher Hitchens, as you no doubt know, is out with a new book called The Trial of Henry A. Kissinger. It is very rough on you. It is a book devoted to criticism
I'm
of you.
I'm not going to deal with Christopher Hitchens. He's a man who's attacked Mother Teresa, Jackie Kennedy. He said the Holocaust never existed. And I'm not going to do him the favor of getting into a debate with him.
I can't have it said that I'm an anti-Semite or a Nazi sympathizer. That, I'm sorry, is too much. It crosses my line. And Dr. Kissinger by now will have heard, I think, from my lawyers that he's to cease and desist from saying what he knows to be false.
I haven't read his book. I frankly was so disgusted by his magazine piece. Look at this guy's background. Sewer pipe sucker. He sucks the sewer pipe.
I was not concerned that Kissinger would sue Harper's Magazine because then he, Kissinger, would have to go to some form of legal disclosure. I mean, if you accuse the magazine or you accuse Hitchens of libel, then that allows our lawyers to ask questions and subpoena documents and try to establish the truth of the matter, and that is not something I think that Kissinger would welcome.
Kissinger's admirers point to his impact as a global strategist. During the Cold War era, he saw international diplomacy as a grand game of finding the right balance between opposing superpowers.
I think that Kissinger's greatest accomplishment was a triangular diplomacy in which he was able to balance China off against the Soviet Union and have America retain a role in the world after Vietnam, when it would have been natural for us to retreat.
Kissinger's critics charge that his worldview blinded him to the human cost of the Cold War. Recently released documents reveal episodes in Indochina, Indonesia, and Chile, where Kissinger may have needlessly sacrificed human lives to pursue strategic goals.
That this man could operate at such a horrible level and not get exposed for year after year after year after year, how many people came out against him? It's an embarrassment to my profession. I gotta tell you, the dark side of Henry Kissinger is very, very dark.
Born in Fürth, Germany in 1923, Henry Kissinger was 10 years old when the Nazis came to power. The son of Jewish academics, he was increasingly alienated from the society in which he lived.
I think Henry Kissinger grew up with that odd mix of ego and insecurity that comes from being the smartest kid in the class, from really knowing that you're more awesomely intelligent than anybody else, but also being the guy who gotten beaten up because he was Jewish.
In 1938, the Kissinger family fled to the United States and settled in New York City. Henry Kissinger was 15. In 1944, just 6 years after emigrating to America, Kissinger returned to Germany, this time wearing an American uniform.
Kissinger was in the counterintelligence corps and was stationed someplace in the American occupation zone. And once or twice we met. I mean, we came out of a totalitarian society. German refugees or Jewish refugees, that was obviously something that weighed on us. We got out early and we didn't suffer the ultimate consequences of being the enemy in a totalitarian society.
When the war ended, Kissinger returned to his hometown, 100 miles south of Buchenwald. The synagogue where his family worshipped had been burned to the ground. 13 of his relatives had died in the camps.
Consciousness that societies can take a very evil turn. This separates me from many Americans who have never seen it, can't imagine it.
I think you can come out of the Holocaust experience with many different outlooks, but there are two extremes, one of which is you say never again, and you have a very moralistic foreign policy. At the other extreme is a great realpolitik, a realism in foreign policy. Kissinger, of course, had a mix of both, but he was mainly on the spectrum of the power politics player. He believed that in the end, what really mattered was power.
After the war, Kissinger was admitted to Harvard. As an undergraduate and then a graduate student, Kissinger earned renown as a student of foreign policy. In his writings, he expressed an interest in Metternich and Otto von Bismarck, men of power, cunning, and skillful diplomacy.
His grounding was European, not just because he came from Europe, because he was a young man when he left, but historically, his intellectual interests, the diplomatic age of Europe. He was fascinated with the art of diplomacy. And of course, in those days, a lot of diplomacy was secret and some of it even duplicitous.
Kissinger's flair for international diplomacy brought him to the attention of Nelson Rockefeller, a Republican politician from one of America's wealthiest families.
Dr. Kissinger, having finished the Rockefeller report, we have just learned, too, that the Russians have sent a man 186 miles into the sky and returned him. Would you care to comment on that?
It seems to me to support the recommendations of the Rockefeller report. It indicates that the Russians have rocket engines of very great thrust and probably of greater thrust than we have at the moment.
In 1957, Henry Kissinger published a book called Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, in which he argued for a bomb shelter in every house and a doctrine of limited nuclear war. In the New York Times, he received an admiring review from Edward Teller, the father of the hydrogen bomb.
The belief of the Rockefeller Group is that we have to go into production on bombers at the same time that we build up our missile force.
As Rockefeller campaigned for the Republican presidential nomination of 1968, Kissinger's aspirations moved beyond academia to the seat of political power in Washington. But at the convention, Rockefeller would lose the nomination to Richard Nixon. His political ambition stalled. Kissinger was offered a position in the Nixon campaign. He declined. But he would soon find an unlikely route to power through the Vietnam War.
No account of the Indochina Wars is complete without the name of Henry Kissinger. It's one of those occasions where the will to power of an individual really counts as a historical fact.
By 1968, Kissinger had visited Vietnam three times and had become an advisor to the Johnson administration. His impression was that the war was unwinnable, but that a withdrawal of U.S. forces would damage American credibility.
Accordingly, I shall not see.
To devote his full attention to finding peace in Vietnam, President Johnson decided not to run for re-election in 1968.
As your president.
Johnson's withdrawal left Vice President Hubert Humphrey to face Richard Nixon. Nixon promised that if elected, he would bring an honorable and just end to the war.
I would not use atomic weapons in Vietnam. I would not invade North Vietnam. And incidentally, I would not invade any of the other countries in the area of Vietnam.
In Paris, representatives of the Johnson administration were negotiating with the North Vietnamese in an effort to end the war.
We'd been in Paris since May of 68, and we got nowhere. Because in retrospect, there was only one issue. Was the United States going to get out and be defeated? And nobody was prepared to say, yes, we've lost the war, it's over.
Kissinger was an advisor to the negotiators who were authorized to provide him with privileged information.
Kissinger was in Paris in September of 1968. I thought he was intelligent, charming, and just a good companion.
But what Davidson and other members of the Johnson team did not know was that on September 10th, Kissinger had contacted the Nixon campaign by telephone.
We certainly did not know it. Kissinger shared his analysis of what was happening with them, and he was probably by far the most brilliant mind available to them and the most sophisticated analyst.
Nixon, as it were, recognizes talent when he sees it. He doesn't like Jews. He doesn't like intellectuals. But he loves Henry Kissinger, because Kissinger knows what to do without being told. Richard Nixon himself says that he admired Kissinger for his ability to supply secret information.
Nixon was afraid that a peace accord in Paris might cost him the election.
Kissinger notices something. Richard Nixon is prepared to undercut Mr. Johnson and Mr. Humphrey, the president and vice president, and their negotiations in Paris.
Kissinger had a very conspiratorial and sometimes manipulative character. He really liked to please various sides. He liked to ingratiate himself. And in the Paris peace talks, he was willing to talk to both the Johnson-Humphrey camp as well as the Nixon camp.
Kissinger told the Nixon campaign that the Johnson team was close to an agreement with North Vietnam. Until the deal was final, the Johnson team wanted to keep the negotiations secret from South Vietnam. But Nixon had opened a secret channel of communication with South Vietnamese President Thieu. The go-between was Anna Chenault.
Information, information, information. And knowing that I travel to Asia quite frequently, messages to South Vietnam always gone through me.
In late September, Kissinger returned to Harvard. As the election approached, he kept in contact with both the negotiators in Paris and with members of the Nixon campaign.
He was getting information from both sides. He probably was giving information to both sides too. And I don't blame him. I mean, after all, he was not sure which side's going to win. Whoever wins, he's going to go to their side.
By the way, Kissinger expected to work for whoever the next president was. He offered me a job in the next administration in September of 1968.
Really?
Yes.
Independent of the president's name?
Right.
On October the 31st, Henry Kissinger called the Nixon campaign to say that there had been a breakthrough in the talks. "I've got some important information," said Kissinger. "They're breaking out the champagne in Paris." 12 hours later, the announcement was made. The bombing of North Vietnam would cease and final negotiations would begin. The prospect of peace gave Humphrey a last-minute surge in the polls.
And then finally, just a few days before the election, we were moving to substantive negotiations for the first time. And there were great hopes at that time.
But just 3 days before the election, President Thieu defied Johnson and refused to join the peace negotiations.
Certainly one reason is the advice they got from Nixon's people. It's clear that they were being told to hold out and not go to Paris.
FBI surveillance of the Nixon team's contacts with Thieu confirmed this. "Hold on," he was told. gonna win. Without the participation of South Vietnam, the peace talks collapsed. Richard Nixon won the popular vote by a margin of less than 1%.
And we know further that Mr. Kissinger's opinion of Mr. Nixon was very low. Why is he suddenly doing this tremendous favor during an election campaign to someone for whom he has nothing but contempt?
Why?
It's in the hope of a political reward.
Dr. Henry Kissinger has agreed to come with the White House staff as the assistant to the president-elect for national security affairs.
I was sitting in the lobby waiting to get to see the president-elect, and there was this Rockefeller man, as he was described to me, going in to see him. And what happened was that Nixon stole the crown jewel out of his longtime adversary's crown, and that was Henry Kissinger, the most brilliant man on the Rockefeller staff.
Dr. Kissinger is perhaps one of the major scholars in America and the world today in this area. He has never yet had a full-time government assignment, and he will bring to this responsibility a fresh approach.
I did not know Richard Nixon when he appointed me as his security advisor. In fact, I had spent three presidential campaigns backing Governor Nelson Rockefeller against Richard Nixon. So when you read about how carefully I plotted my way into Nixon's proximity, I want to teach that to your children. Say, support the opponent of the man you, for whom you want to work.
Do I think he saw what he did as betrayal of the peace process or the move by Johnson to stop the bombing halt? I really think this guy doesn't see it that way. He saw it as a means to an end, which is why he's such a good apparatchik. His end was getting that job.
I, Richard Bilhouse Nixon, do solemnly swear.
Upon taking office, Nixon and Kissinger moved to structure the administration in a way that would give the new national security advisor unprecedented power.
Dr. Kissinger is setting up at the present time a very exciting new procedure to revitalize the National Security Council.
It centralized control. It gave Nixon, you know, and Kissinger on foreign policy a tremendous amount of sort of day-to-day control. They can control the paper movement, but they can control a lot of the policy options.
It's true also that Henry Kissinger chaired most of the committees and subcommittees, and that gave him unusual authority.
For his staff, Kissinger personally selected a team of policy experts drawn from academia.
I liked him very much, and I was happy to follow him. I told him in September, where thou goest, I goest.
He's the most gifted man to work in American foreign policy in any generation since World War II.
Kissinger also invited Harvard scholar Roger Morris to join the National Security Council.
Nixon set the general line of American policy, but Kissinger really is the conductor of the train. He's the engineer. He's the policymaker, who most importantly is in liaison with the Pentagon, with the Joint Chiefs of Staff, with the CIA. He's conducting the diplomacy as well as the military policy.
The major immediate goal of our foreign policy is to bring an end to the war in Vietnam in a way.
In public, Nixon renewed his campaign pledge to bring an honorable end to the war. In private, the president shared Kissinger's view that the best peace would be achieved through force.
If Moscow had been convinced that we were going to do everything necessary to win that war and win it promptly, they would have advised their clients to pull back.
Kissinger's definition of an honorable end or of a decent end to the war, I think, had nothing much to do with honor or with decency. It had to do with American credibility vis-a-vis the Soviets and, in the long run, vis-a-vis the Chinese. Kissinger was concerned, and so was Nixon, that the United States not appear weak or indecisive or vacillating.
As Kissinger is supposed to have said, and I don't know if he ever did, that our goal is to have a decent interval between the withdrawal of American forces and the rape of the first virgin.
They were looking for, remember what the 68 campaign was about, they had a plan. They were looking for an easy way to get out. The Vietnam War had just undone the predecessor, President Johnson. it's hard for you to understand what a huge burden this was on these people.
In order to achieve peace with honor, Nixon and Kissinger wanted to show Hanoi that the new president would use extreme force to prosecute the war, that he was capable of anything. It was an idea called the madman theory. Less than a month into Nixon's presidency, he and Kissinger began planning an attack against North Vietnamese sanctuaries in neighboring Cambodia.
The Americans started bombing Cambodia in 1969, soon after Nixon came into office, because they had a problem. The problem was that whole areas of eastern Cambodia, which was in theory a neutral country, not on the side of the North Vietnamese or the South Vietnamese, whole areas of the country had been taken over by the North Vietnamese communists, and they were using them as staging areas and bases for their attacks on the South Vietnamese armies in South Vietnam and upon the American army in South Vietnam.
Cambodia, Thailand, they were going to overrun the whole peninsula.
This became one of those, the great myths of the Vietnam War, was that the key to success was getting rid of the Vietnamese communist bases on the Cambodian side of the border.
Cambodia's enigmatic Prince Sihanouk had managed to keep his country out of the Vietnam War. He hoped to avoid taking sides and so prevent an open violation of Cambodia's neutrality.
And this led to all sorts of problems, because taking the war secretly into a neutral country meant you had to destroy the actual records or to conceal them very effectively, to lie, in fact.
Well, it was the motivation was for the secrecy because it was illegal. So, I mean, that's simple.
Under the U.S. Constitution, bombing Cambodia was an act of war that would require the approval of the U.S. Congress.
I don't know that Congress would have allowed it. The last thing Congress wanted then was an expansion of a war.
In February 1969, in a secret meeting on Air Force One, Kissinger and his aide, Alexander Haig, met with Air Force Colonel Ray Sitton to plan for the secret bombing of Cambodia.
What Kissinger wanted done was they asked Sitton to find a way to master bombing so nobody would know what's going on, and Sitton did. He found a way.
The initial secret bombing of Cambodia in 1969 was called Operation Menu, and each of the targets were different, or supposed to be different, North Vietnamese bases in Cambodia, and they were called after names of meals: breakfast, lunch, dinner, snack.
Starting with breakfast, Kissinger approved a plan to conceal the Cambodian bombing missions from military records. Under this dual reporting system, B-52 pilots would be pre-assigned targets in South Vietnam. In mid-flight, their planes would be rerouted by ground radar stations and guided to secret targets in Cambodia. The returning pilots would report that their bombs had been dropped on South Vietnam. Cambodia would never appear in the record.
I think Kissinger is clearly an extraordinarily brilliant man. Brilliant and also manipulative and also very secretive.
Under Kissinger's supervision, the U.S. flew 3,600 secret missions over Cambodia in 14 months, dropping 110,000 tons of bombs. Colonel Sitton recalled that Henry Kissinger was intimately involved in the direction and timing of the bombing raids.
Real attention to the cruelties of the details, picking targets, selecting hamlets and villages to be bombed.
It is an absurdity to say that a country can occupy a part of another country, kill your people, and that then you are violating its neutrality when you respond against the foreign troops that are on that neutral territory. It is total hypocrisy.
1 week after the first bombs had fallen in Cambodia, rumors of the operation began to surface in the press. Kissinger contacted the FBI to request that wiretaps be used to find the source of the leaks.
He wiretapped American journalists with whom he had supposedly friendly and close relations.
It legitimized me. There I was, a reporter, writer, commentator for the New York Times, and everybody felt a little creepy about, you know, here's this Nixon apologist writing for the Times. But then when it turned out that I was wiretapped, all of a sudden I was in a new fraternity.
He wiretapped aides and associates in the Pentagon.
I was one of the people who was wiretapped while serving under him. I cannot forgive him for being a party to it or for never apologizing.
It was not one of the things that filled me with wild joy. On the other hand, it also seemed a way by which it could be demonstrated that my staff was loyal, but I'm sure there were a complex of reasons that went into it.
To some, the wiretapping was just a part of a campaign by Kissinger to fortify his position as Nixon's deputy.
He was endlessly playing off his own staff, one against the other, and playing them off against the president.
And there was a lot of jockeying, particularly on Henry's part, for position.
And Kissinger was determined to accrete as much power as possible to him.
We used to joke that the real hostile foreign powers were not Moscow or Beijing or any of our rivals in the world. The real hostile powers were the rest of the American government, the Department of State, the White House staff, the CIA, the Defense Department. Those were Henry's principal adversaries because they were the rivals for power in Washington.
Like a moth to flame, Henry Kissinger was always attracted to his critics, and the best way to get him to return your phone call was to write something negative.
He understood more about my profession than most of us. He always understood if he could get the three networks and Time and Newsweek, he was home free.
What makes a man sexy? What is it? Is it money, the whole thing? And Henry says, power. It is the ultimate aphrodisiac. Cultivated the press before anybody even knew it was possible to do.
He realized that in this celebrity-obsessed age, that if you became a celebrity, it gave you more power.
I was at a party, and a young lady came up to me and said, "Are you a swinger?" And I said, "I'm too busy to do any public swinging, and I don't want you to think that I don't do any swinging, so why don't you just assume I'm a secret swinger?"
Henry used his flamboyant personal life to cover up his professional life, and it gave him a lot of cover. He could go and have meetings. He could do things. He could take stands. And everybody's concentrating on, Kissinger the swinger. I know you broke their hearts for half the dozen now, bit by bit. You made them cry.
Many poor girls cry. Kissinger loved the thrill of dating starlets, dating beautiful women. These were not deep romantic attachments. This wasn't some great sexual desire as much as a sense of fun, a sense of knowing that he could be in the limelight, that he could be with beautiful people, that he got a thrill from it.
And we get to the restaurant, and Sinatra, who was terribly paranoid, he's saying, everybody says I have mafia connections. I don't have mafia connections. And Henry said, "That's too bad, Frank. I need somebody to take care of my enemies."
Kissinger's enemies in Vietnam continued to haunt him. While the war dragged on, an official State Department delegation met with the North Vietnamese in Paris. But Kissinger was confident he could secure more favorable terms. He opened a second channel of secret talks with North Vietnamese negotiator Lê Duc Tho.
And we were told that those negotiations were to be kept secret, not only, of course, from the public, not only from the media, but also from the rest of the U.S. government. Neither the Secretary of State nor the Secretary of Defense were to know anything about it. And Henry was flying off quite secretly on weekends to meet with Lê Duc Tho and Swan Tri in Paris at a safe house. This was all very conspiratorial, full of intrigue, which he loved. He put out the story that he was meeting a girlfriend, Jill St. John or someone in New York, when in fact he was in Paris negotiating with the North Vietnamese.
How do I get out of here?
We thought you weren't having a meeting today, sir.
Well, do something surprising.
To have a secret rendezvous in Paris.
It certainly is.
Will you be meeting again tomorrow, sir?
We expect to, yes.
Kissinger's secret talks made little progress toward peace in Vietnam, but they did expand his power in Washington.
The negotiations that he conducted were a way of exercising his own control, establishing his own authority in the negotiating process.
as it became apparent that Nixon would turn to Henry for strategy. He gained in that influence, and he gained some more self-confidence and made an enormous contribution to Nixon's policy.
Nixon and Kissinger's Vietnam strategy was still entangled in Cambodia. The secret bombing had failed to destroy the sanctuaries. The North Vietnamese had formed an alliance with Cambodian communists and had moved deeper into the country. Prince Sihanouk, the one man capable of uniting the nation, was deposed in a CIA-supported coup.
The Cambodian coup set off a kind of chain reaction inside the American government, in Richard Nixon and in Henry Kissinger.
Denying CIA support for the coup, Kissinger and Nixon announced U.S. support for the coup leader, Lon Nol, who promptly attacked the North Vietnamese. North Vietnam counterattacked and moved even deeper into Cambodia.
They saw that as a challenge, again, to American strength, to the credibility of American foreign policy.
Nixon decided to invade Cambodia to send a message to North Vietnam. A few days before the invasion, Nixon had a friend relay a message to Kissinger. The president wants you to know, Henry, that if this doesn't work, it's your ass. Kissinger told his staff, our peerless leader has flipped out. But Kissinger defended and implemented the decision to invade, saying it would scare North Vietnam. Nixon would be more emphatic. He said, let's go blow the hell out of them.
I decided to resign, along with Tony Lake and with Bill Watts, our colleague on the NSC staff, because I felt that the Cambodian invasion was a betrayal of the president's pledge to seek an honorable and just peace in Vietnam. I knew that peace was within our grasp. I was intimately involved in the negotiations. I knew that the other side was ready to agree, that we were ready to agree, and that the Cambodian invasion really destroyed all of that, devastated it for years to come, and literally cost tens of thousands of American lives, hundreds of thousands of Vietnamese lives.
On April the 30th, 1970, U.S. forces invaded Cambodia.
Armed forces of South Vietnam, attacks are being launched this week to clean out major enemy sanctuaries on the Cambodian-Vietnam border.
As news of the invasion spread, the U.S. domestic reaction was explosive. Nearly 500 American universities shut down, and on the morning of May 4th, National Guardsmen opened fire on 15 students at Kent State University, killing four. As Nixon promised publicly to remove forces from Cambodia, Kissinger reviewed a plan to increase the pressure on North Vietnam to surrender.
Henry Kissinger began in the fall of 1969 in September to plan a savage, brutal blow against North Vietnam. These were his words. He said to us as a planning group, I can't believe that a fourth-rate power like North Vietnam does not have a breaking point.
For 11 days in December of 1972, in what became known as the Christmas bombing, 129 B-52 bombers dropped 40,000 tons of bombs on Hanoi and Haiphong, hitting a hospital and other urban centers. What many did not know was that Kissinger had struck a peace accord with North Vietnam 2 months before. But South Vietnam's President Thieu, the man who had undermined the 68 peace talks, would not accept the deal without proof that the Americans would enforce it.
The Christmas bombing had much more to do with the South Vietnamese than with the North. It was a gesture to the Thieu regime. It was a way of saying the United States is willing to make this one great last brutal blow against the North.
They bombed the North Vietnamese simply to persuade the South Vietnamese that they meant it. It was a demonstration bombing. It was a public relations mass murder from the sky.
The bombing did appease the South, and Kissinger persuaded the North Vietnamese to make a few cosmetic concessions. In January 1973, Kissinger signed a peace accord with North Vietnamese negotiator Lê Duc Tho. The terms of peace were almost identical to the terms the Johnson administration had nearly secured before the election of 1968.
half the names on the Vietnam Veterans Memorial are incised in stone for dates after January 1969. There is enough marble in Washington to put all the names on one wall. We wouldn't dare try and put up a wall that had the names of all the Vietnamese on it who died in that period.
When I shall receive the award, together with my old colleague in the search for peace in Vietnam, Mr. Lee Duc Tho.
In 1973, Kissinger and Lee Duc Tho were jointly awarded the Nobel Prize for Peace.
It will symbolize the end of the anguish and the suffering.
But to his embarrassment, Kissinger was unaware that Lee Duc Tho would not attend the ceremony in Oslo.
The Vietnamese counterpart with whom he shared it, Mr. Lee Duc Tho, refused to accept the prize on the perfectly excellent pragmatic grounds that there was no peace in Vietnam to celebrate, so there shouldn't be a prize for it.
I thought it was a terrible travesty that he should be awarded a peace prize when, in fact, he was a war maker, not a war ender.
Dr. Kissinger, what would you say was the high point of your tenure as Secretary of State?
Well, I would say in 1973, when I won the Nobel Peace Prize for ending the Vietnam War.
And the low point?
I'd say 1975, when the Vietnam War ended.
Once the Paris Peace Accords were signed in December of 72, that ended the American direct involvement in Vietnam.
But to preserve peace with honor, Nixon and Kissinger decided to defend the anti-communist regime in Cambodia. It was to be a secret mission, airstrikes against communist forces directed by the American embassy in Phnom Penh.
It made free the American Air Force. They could not bomb in Laos, they could not bomb in Vietnam, so that began the incredible bombing of Cambodia. And this is when the number of bombs dropped equaled the amount of bombs dropped on Japan during World War II.
Elizabeth Becker covered the war in Cambodia from 1972 to 1974.
We would be able to hear the conversation between the pilot, the American pilot in the air, and the American embassy, which was illegally directing the airstrikes. We couldn't understand why there were so many civilian casualties in this war. Why were they hitting all these civilians and villages? It was, you know, every nightmare of how you fight a war.
From 1969 to 1973, more than 500,000 Cambodians died. By 1974, the bombing had disrupted the nation's agricultural system and a famine ensued. Over 2 million refugees poured into overcrowded cities.
American policy in those years towards Cambodia helped create the conditions, perhaps the only conditions, in which the Khmer Rouge came to power.
The Khmer Rouge drew strength from the chaos of the country. When they seized power in 1975, they forced populations of entire cities back to the countryside. Then they began a policy of exterminating their enemies in execution grounds that came to be known as killing fields. By 1979, another 3 million Cambodians had lost their lives.
No one knew what the Khmer Rouge were going to do. It's quite wrong to blame the United States for the murderousness of the Khmer Rouge. That's a disgracefully dishonest thing to try to do. But the carelessness with which the United States treated Cambodia as a sideshow to Vietnam did lead to disaster to Cambodia.
Congress authorized money for bombs in South Vietnam, and they went into Cambodia. And there's a criminal act for you, you know, lying. And therefore, I think anybody who died in Cambodia, you could argue criminally that they were guilty of murder one. You know, people did it. Nobody authorized them to bomb Cambodia.
There was no American war in Cambodia before President Nixon and Dr. Kissinger.
That is totally incorrect. I think we inherited a tragedy. We attended to and succeeded in extricating America with honor from this tragedy.
Oh, we inherited it. No, you did not inherit it. You created, you were the designers of the Cambodian policy.
Crimes against humanity are crimes that comprise genocide or torture or mass murder committed on a widespread and systematic basis against innocent civilian populations.
You're talking about war crimes, for example. When World War II started and Germany first bombed London, everyone was horrified. Bombing cities, that was criminal behavior. You bombed troops, you didn't bomb innocent civilians. By the time the war was over, we had virtually wiped out Dresden, for example, in one of the most horrible bombing raids ever. And Tokyo, we virtually burned to the ground. So, was that criminal? Perhaps.
In July 1973, the detection of Nixon's taping system would lead to the discovery of the Watergate cover-up, the indictment of key members of the White House staff, and the end of the Nixon presidency.
The lies that had to be told by the administration over Cambodia led eventually to the employment of the plumbers, which was the secret White House team employed to stop leaks, which led to Watergate, which led to the fall of Nixon. So in a way, the bombing of Cambodia was the first step in the chain that led to the fall of Nixon.
Nixon resigned rather than face impeachment. One of the original articles of impeachment addressed the concealment of the Cambodian bombing from Congress. When the impeachment was dropped, so was the investigation into the secret bombing. The new president, Gerald Ford, retained Henry Kissinger as his Secretary of State and pardoned Richard Nixon.
Nixon managed to cop a shameful plea, accept a pardon. His Attorney General, former campaign manager, John Mitchell, is put in an orange jumpsuit and sent down the river. No attorney general's ever been to jail before. But there are more members of the Nixon group, all of them bound to each other by a criminal understanding. There's only one of them left of the people who were involved in the foreign domestic crimes of that era.
We're delighted to have such a large turnout tonight for what I know will be an informative and perhaps provocative evening with our guest, Dr. Henry Kissinger.
I would like to point out that for a while I was both National Security Advisor and Secretary of State. And the reason I mention that is because never before and never since have relations between the White House and the State Department been as harmonious as they were in those days.
Kissinger has written three best-selling books about his life. But in the deed of his government papers to the Library of Congress, he has not allowed anyone else to access them until 5 years after his death.
Was the deed of the paper the right thing to do? Was it, did it further our understanding of how they operated, you know, I mean, by putting those papers away? No, of course not. It simply was an act of a man who did not dare to have in his lifetime the real papers and the real documents of his administration become known.
As Secretary of State under Ford, Henry Kissinger still saw conflicts between superpowers extend to the smallest corners of the world. In East Timor, a small island in the Indonesian archipelago, Henry Kissinger saw a communist threat to the global balance of power.
The Indonesian dictatorship thought it would be better if Indonesia occupied and annexed the people and territory of East Timor. So they evolved a plan whereby they took the land and they subjected the people to a campaign of genocide. But what isn't as widely known as it could be or should be is that on the day they took that decision, Henry Kissinger was sitting in the room with the Indonesian general staff.
Good evening from Jakarta, Indonesia, the latest stop on President Ford's Asian tour.
On December the 5th, 1975, President Gerald Ford and Henry Kissinger arrived to meet with Indonesian President Suharto.
The President's Day in Indonesia will be taken up mostly by ceremony.
Ford and Kissinger wanted to strengthen diplomatic ties with Indonesia, a non-communist ally between Australia and Vietnam that controlled crucial sea lanes.
There's more to this trip than China politics and security for Southeast Asia. Indonesia is a major oil producer, and coal reserves have been discovered on the islands. Reasons enough for the United States to want to maintain good relations.
Dr. Kissinger met with, along with President Ford, with President Suharto, and I was present at that meeting Many have interpreted that meeting as Dr. Kissinger's giving a green light to the subsequent Indonesian invasion of Timor.
East Timor was seeking its independence from Portugal. Kissinger had long been aware of the growing popularity in East Timor of a left-wing independence movement called Fretilin.
The Indonesian military throughout this period was concerned that there not be a separate independent entity developed on one half of one of their islands with strong Chinese communist influence. When Dr. Kissinger came, I think the decision had already been made by the Indonesians that the efforts to negotiate with the Portuguese had not come to fruition, and therefore they needed to take direct military action.
But any military action would involve U.S. weapons, which had been sold solely for self-defense. On December 6, as Ford and Kissinger concluded their visit, preparations were underway for an invasion.
Why, they ask, are the Indonesians invading us? Why, they ask, if the Indonesians believe that Fretilin is communist, do they not send a delegation to Dili to find out? Why, they ask, are the Australians not helping us? When the Japanese invaded, they did help us. Why, they ask, are the Portuguese not helping us? We're still a Portuguese colony. Who, they ask, will pay for the terrible damage to our homes?
One day after this report, Greg Shackleton was killed in East Timor.
What we saw was the massacre of thousands of people as a result of the constant attack of the Indonesian army, from the air, from the sea and land attack.
A lot of people are being killed, I repeat, indiscriminately.
With no cameras to witness the invasion, a radio transmission from the Red Cross is the only live record of the horror of the event.
What I saw was that my own government was very much involved in what was going on in East Timor. We were providing most of the weaponry, helicopters, logistical support, food, uniforms, ammunition, all the expendables that the Indonesians needed to conduct this war. You can be 100% certain that Suharto was explicitly given the green light to do what he did.
The invasion, executions, destruction of the land and resulting famine cost the lives of over 100,000 Timorese. In interviews, Kissinger has long denied that he discussed the invasion in the meeting with Suharto.
We were told at the airport as we left Jakarta that either that day or the next day they intended to take East Timor.
Well, I don't want to take issue with the accuracy of Dr. Kissinger's memoirs, but it was mentioned in the meeting with Suharto. As I recall, Suharto was quite candid, said that after several months of trying to resolve this through negotiation, the Indonesians felt they had to take direct action.
1 week after this interview, the transcript of the meeting with Suharto was released. Suharto, I would like to speak to you, Mr. President, about another problem, Timor. We want your understanding if we deem it necessary to take rapid or drastic action. Ford, we will understand and will not press you on this issue. We understand the problem you have and the intentions you have. Kissinger, you appreciate that the use of U.S.-made arms could create problems. It depends on how we construe it, whether it is in self-defense or is a foreign operation. It is important that whatever you do succeeds quickly. We would be able to influence the reaction in America if whatever happens, happens after we return.
And the U.S. government knew exactly what was happening in those first days of the invasion, December 7th, 8th, 9th. Thousands of Timorese were killed.
reports of people being herded into school buildings by Indonesian soldiers with the buildings set on fire, and anyone trying to get out being shot, but most of the people being burned alive. People being herded into fields and machine gunned. People being hunted down in the mountains, so anyone out there was in what amounted to a free fire zone.
The Indonesians did not handle it very well from the standpoint of the global community. But again, our leverage was limited, and it was seen in 1975, 76, in the light of the post-Vietnam era as a very important country to us.
And it happened in a year when Southeast Asia, when Indochina had collapsed. So it wasn't a question of approval, it was a question of not being able to do anything about it.
Knowing full well how many people were killed, they were so concerned at the U.S. State Department that they cabled Henry Kissinger twice, saying that the U.S. Congress would cut off military aid and the bilateral weapon sales to Indonesia, because clearly Indonesia was using these weapons for offensive purposes.
And it would be hard to make a case that Indonesia was threatened by an invasion from East Timor. So while Kissinger's in the air, flying home, the State Department has to issue these statements. It's a matter of law, and they have to say Congress may indeed cut off aid as a result of this, as a legal matter. When he returns from his trip to Indonesia, to the State Department, he comes back to a bureaucratic row at his office. Kissinger is furious.
Kissinger, I want to raise a little bit of hell about the department's conduct in my absence. Take this cable on East Timor. It will leak, and it will go to Congress too. And then we will have hearings on it, and it will come out that Kissinger overruled his pristine bureaucrats and violated the law.
The Arms Export Control Act and the Foreign Assistance Act passed by Congress that limit the ways in which American weaponry can be used, and they confine these uses to external self-defense.
Kissinger, and we can't construe a communist government in the middle of Indonesia as self-defense? Lee, well, Kissinger, then you're saying that arms can't be used for defense. No, they can be used for the defense of Indonesia. Kissinger, I know what the law is, but how can it be in the U.S. national interest for us to kick the Indonesians in the teeth? The meeting concluded with a discussion about how to mislead Congress about arms sales, which did continue after a brief hiatus. In a later meeting, one of Kissinger's aides confirmed that normal relations with Indonesia had resumed. Not very willingly, said Kissinger. Illegally. And beautifully. Today, Henry Kissinger is a successful businessman. He runs a firm called Kissinger Associates, in which he uses his diplomatic experience to help businesses around the world. But while Kissinger may profit from past connections, he is also haunted by them. Last year, Kissinger was enjoying a trip to Paris when a French judge served him with a subpoena to answer questions about U.S. involvement in Chile 30 years ago. At issue was Operation Condor, a campaign of murder and torture conducted by the regime of Augusto Pinochet.
The arrest of Augusto Pinochet in London in October of 1998 directly led to pressure on the Clinton administration to declassify hundreds of thousands of documents, secret documents from the CIA, from the State Department and elsewhere, blacked out as they are. These documents are really rather extraordinary. There's a paper trail right up to Kissinger's office that help us revisit this history and understand our efforts to overthrow covertly a democratically elected government in Chile.
I really think Chile was probably the basis and the most corrupt of all the actions because it had nothing to do with national security.
Copper is used all over the world, but the largest known reserve of copper ore is in South America, in the Republic of Chile.
In the 1960s, Chile was fertile soil for American corporate interests, including AT&T, which controlled the copper industry, and Pepsi-Cola. Early in 1970, Pepsi and AT&T were concerned about political developments in Chile. As the country's democratic presidential elections approached, a left-wing candidate named Salvador Allende was gaining popular support. His ties to Fidel Castro were of particular concern.
He was the spokesman for Castro everywhere. As part of his electoral platform, he had said he would not accept American aid. He had inveighed against American capitalism, described the United States as not really being a democracy, but the Soviet Union was a democracy.
Allende promised to nationalize Chile's copper industry, a direct threat to AT&T and concern to other U.S. corporations.
I directed that an approach be made to both the State Department and Mr. Kissinger's office to tell them that we had grave concern over the outlook for AT&T's investment.
As AT&T called on Kissinger to take action against Allende, Pepsi President Donald Kendall echoed the same concern to an old friend, Richard Nixon.
If he does it right in Chile, he's going to ensure a good flow of campaign money in 71 and 72. He's got a lot of big money people that want him to do something about Chile. So Chile became the most important national security item they had.
What brought about the changes in Chile were the facts that it was being communized by Allende.
On September 4th, Allende won a plurality of the vote. It appeared certain that his victory would be confirmed by the Chilean Congress.
The election in Chile has been won, but the president has not been confirmed, the new president, Salvador Allende. Chile has, like the United States, a transition period of about 60 days.
The CIA declared that Chile under Allende would not be a threat to the United States, but Nixon found the prospect of an Allende presidency unacceptable.
As advisor to Richard Nixon, Kissinger followed Machiavelli's rule of flattering, adulating, and serving the powerful to be a success.
In a September meeting, Kissinger shared his views on Chile's democratic election. I don't see why we need to stand by and watch a country go communist due to the irresponsibility of its people. On September 15th, Nixon met in the Oval Office with Kissinger and Richard Helms, director of the CIA. Helms' handwritten notes reveal a plan to prevent Allende from coming to power. Not concerned risks involved. No involvement of embassy. 10 million available, more if necessary. An internal CIA memo dated September 16th outlines the official but secret policy implemented by the CIA under the supervision of Henry Kissinger. Kissinger asked Helms to report directly to him on the details of coup operations. Concealed from the Departments of State and Defense, as well as the U.S. Embassy in Chile, this plan for covert action became known as Track 2.
Of course, that was a broad policy. I make no excuses for that. It should have been. Another Marxist regime in the hemisphere? No.
In a meeting with Haig and others, Kissinger emphasized that drastic action was called for to shock the Chileans.
Kissinger really became the general manager of this covert operation, representing the President of the United States. He ignored the advice of his own staff that a coup was not possible.
I decided to start sending these increasingly worrying alarms to Kissinger, that anything that might be tried would be an utter failure. The Chilean military was not going to engage in anything. Allende was certainly going to be elected. Nothing could stop it.
Kissinger swept aside these objections and pressed the CIA to go forward to foment a military coup.
But the third cable was the one that really excited Kissinger, because it said unequivocally that if any adventure were undertaken, it would boomerang against the United States and personally against the president, worse than the Bay of Pigs. That was the cable that got me a summons home right away, because they thought I had stumbled on their plot.
Fine, we'll call you later.
So I flew to Washington. President greeted me. He then launched into a denunciation of Allende. He kept hitting his hand like that. He was going to smash Allende economically. Kept referring to him as that bastard, that SOB. He was going to smash him.
With the inauguration approaching, word of possible covert action against Allende reached General René Schneider, head of the Chilean military. Schneider announced he would uphold Allende's confirmation by the Chilean Congress. he was unaware that men from within his own ranks were being recruited by the CIA.
Mi padre era una persona muy tierna, sí. Mi papá era una persona que no mentía, que lo que decía lo cumplía. Y la ley significaba que la decisión de quién era presidente de Chile la iba a tomar el Congreso. Esto, obviamente, a sectores no les gustó y comenzaron a atacar a
The senior military officer, General René Schneider, is thought of as the principal obstacle to a military coup because he believes the Chilean armed forces take their oath only to the Constitution.
In Santiago, the CIA helped design a plan to kidnap Schneider.
They thought they would provoke the military into declaring martial law, suspending the elections.
The CIA's Santiago station chief cabled Washington. General Schneider is the main barrier to all plans for the military to take over. Washington cabled back, constant pressure from the White House, more important than ever to remove him.
It's therefore decided Schneider must go. And for this task, men of proven record of criminal violence are recruited. They're given sophisticated assassination weaponry through the United States diplomatic bag.
A Track 2 CIA communique confirms this. The cable reports that plans against Schneider were moving along, requesting 8 to 10 tear gas grenades, three 45 caliber machine guns with 500 rounds ammo each.
And they're given large financial inducement.
The money was gathered and handled through a CIA channels back with me. No one sat on it long enough to hatch an egg. You know, it was too hot to hold.
In late September, Weimert, then U.S. military attaché, had been secretly assigned to work directly with the CIA in Santiago. An avid equestrian, Weimert's love of horses had made him a close associate of officers in the Chilean military, an ideal go-between. The CIA station gave Weimert a war chest of cash to pay out to anti-Allende groups.
I couldn't put it in my office safe. So I stuck it. It was done in long rubber bands, $250,000. And I put it in my riding boots, and no one else moved the boots but me. And that was the best place to keep it.
On October the 15th, Kissinger received word that Track 2 coup plotters had made a failed attempt to kidnap General Schneider. In a meeting with the CIA, he expressed his concern that plans for a coup at this time cannot succeed. In his memoirs, Kissinger would later write that he had turned off Track 2 at this meeting. But the very next day, the CIA sent a cable to Chile. It is firm and continuing policy that Allende be overthrown by a coup. It is imperative that these actions be implemented clandestinely and securely so that the United States government and American hand be well hidden.
If you're Henry Kissinger, everybody knows what you want. Does he know that they know what he wants? Sure. Does he know what they're going to do or how they're going to do it? Are you kidding? Anybody that would tell him what's going to happen is never going to do a briefing again. Do you really think somebody would take a piece of paper into the White House that say a consequence of this may be a death of somebody? Do you really think so? No.
Immediate Santiago. Submachine guns and ammo being sent by regular courier, leaving Washington 0700 hours, 19 October. Due arrive Santiago late evening 20 October or early morning 21 October. Preferred use regular courier to avoid bringing undue attention to operation.
Mi padre salió de aquí tipo 8 de la mañana en un auto que iba solamente con su chofer. Llegaron a la esquina de... iban llegando a la esquina de Martín Zamora con Américo Vespucio y el auto ahí fue rodeado por otros y se le impidió el paso. De un jeep que queda al otro costado sale gente, rompen el vidrio con un mazo y disparan hacia adentro. Muchos disparos, te fijas.
When they moved the stop sign that morning, and his chauffeur didn't pay that much attention to it, for driving, he went the same way all the time. And then here one morning, He goes to go there, and it's blocked off. And it's over here, and then they stopped the car, and they shot him.
Was it American mischief? You know, that was investigated ad nauseum by an opposition senator, Church. Mm-hmm. And if you read the Church hearings, it's all there. And nobody was indicted. Nobody was charged with illegal acts.
Mr. Kissinger, his presence here should not be interpreted as meaning that he himself was ever involved in any plot to assassinate any foreign figure.
In the Church Committee, the CIA testified that Kissinger had been kept fully informed of the Schneider situation every step of the way, even after October 15th. Kissinger maintained that he turned off all coup plotting on October 15th.
For Kissinger to be correct, this would go down in history as one of the greatest misunderstandings between the White House and the CIA. But when you read the documents, Kissinger was very clear. He said, "Let us keep pressure on every Allende weak spot in sight, now and into the future until such time as new marching orders are given." The CIA walked away from its meeting with Henry Kissinger, believing it had been mandated to continue trying to foment a coup in Chile.
On October 19th, according to the CIA, Kissinger's aide, Alexander Haig, was briefed by the CIA on continuing coup attempts.
One can only presume that Alexander Haig, whose duty it was to report to Kissinger on this type of information, fully briefed Kissinger on what the CIA told him.
According to the CIA, on October 20th, 5 days after Kissinger claimed he had turned off Track 2, he demanded an update on the Schneider situation.
There was no policy since to assassinate any foreign official.
Kissinger said there was no plot I am familiar with. I was not involved.
You are.
He lied.
As far as we were concerned in the White House, the thing ended on October 15th. Mm-hmm. Then I think around October 23rd or so, I don't remember the exact date, they kidnapped Schneider and in the process killed him.
It may be impossible to know precisely what happened, yet it is hard to understand how, on October 19th, the CIA could have shipped unmarked guns to Chile without authorization.
He knew Schneider was certainly going to get killed, but not by us. You see, therefore it's okay. That's the way it works.
Not assassination and not murder. That the hearing was very clear about that. It was accidental in terms of the United States.
But isn't kidnapping a crime?
Well, kidnapping is it depends on what your objectives are. I'm not going to justify it. They were not my policy.
If you were found standing over a dead man in the street with a smoking gun in your hands and the police come and you say, "Well, I'm sorry, but I was only trying to kidnap him," this in court does you no good at all. A murder committed in the course of a kidnap, any action committed in the course of a kidnap, aggravates the offense.
The Chilean police investigation did not find any evidence to support a kidnapping. After the murder, the CIA commended the Chilean station for doing an excellent job. A CIA internal inquiry revealed that $35,000 was paid to one of the killers after the killing. Perhaps only a legal inquiry will reveal the truth.
If you could develop a scenario, if you could develop a factual basis to find that Henry Kissinger was complicit, then you could sue him in the courts of the United States. You might face some statute of limitations problems, which you'd have to try to overcome by saying that the duplicity with which Henry Kissinger has dealt with these issues, saying one thing for the official record and another thing in private and hitherto unreleased records, there'd be some ground on which to say that the statute of limitations was told by that kind of concealment.
Yo pienso que Henry Kissinger era el jefe de toda esta confabulación. Veía a mi padre como el obstáculo. O sea, este era una especie de insecto que estaba ahí, que estaba molestando, ¿te fijas? Y ese insecto era mi padre, ¿no?
¿Hay planes para dar paso jurídico?
Estamos pensándolo.
After Schneider's death, Allende was elected, but the efforts of Kissinger and Nixon to overthrow Allende would ultimately succeed. In 1973, military forces launched a coup in Santiago, killing Allende. Augusto Pinochet would assume power and begin a reign of terror that would last 17 years. The date was September 11th. 28 years later to the day, the Washington Post announced a lawsuit brought against Henry Kissinger by Renny Schneider Jr. to the death of his father. The news would be overshadowed by the events of later that morning.
I'm sure they would want your observations on what you see here.
On the one hand, it's a testimony to what evil can do in the world. But what the mayor and his associates have done here shows the resilience and the power of the human spirit.
As the former Secretary of State surveyed the wreckage, the campaign had already begun to see that those responsible for the loss of innocent life be captured and brought to justice.
I don't think you could have it metaphorically more perfect than that. The hunt for those who will use force against civilians or against democracy for short-term or fanatical aims of their own is now a hunt in which the whole world takes part. And there can't be any exceptions.
Whether or not Kissinger is guilty of crimes against humanity, his case raises issues about the accountability of public figures, the way the past haunts the present, and the movement for universal justice.
All revolutions are impossible till they happen. Then they become inevitable. Well, one of the things that's happened is that this movement has acquired an air of inevitability.
139 nations have become signatories to the International Criminal Court, a global judiciary with the power to try individuals for crimes against humanity.
I think the idea of Kissinger as a war criminal is a very dangerous idea. As you know, America has not signed up for the International Criminal Tribunal for fear of this.
In his latest book, On International Affairs, Henry Kissinger argues strongly against what he calls the pitfalls of universal jurisdiction.
It's a facet of American exceptionalism to think that international law is a very fine thing for other countries, that international law applies to everyone except Americans.
The average person thinks that morality can be applied as directly to the conduct of states, to each other, as it can to human relations. That is not always the case, because sometimes statesmen have to choose among evils.
I do think that somewhere down deep, he knows what he was doing. He knows it was against a lot of first principles, which is why so much is masked and hidden, and there's so much distrust. It's a very, very sad way to go through your life. Whatever he did, whatever he accomplished, I'm not sure it's worth it, because he had to live a lot more years. You know, he's been out of power for a long time, you know, 25 years now. In his own way, the reason I don't worry about war crimes or anything else, he's got his own sentence. He's got to live with himself.